one and only.
He's almost apologizing to the guy for hitting.
Ross Rubin's game plan in this fight with two wins. He's not very fast, but he's limping. Look at this.
He's limping. People who have never seen Ross Rubin fight, just watch this.
My name is Bas Rutten. I became a professional mixed martial artist in 93. I started. I won 3 world titles in Japan. I won a world title in America, the UFC. I got inducted into the UFC Hall of Fame. I hold a bunch of black belts on the different kind of arts. I was a Thai boxer. All that together formed me in this crazy person who's now in America, living the American dream, doing some TV work. My early childhood memories, there were not such fun memories. I was a very sick kid. I was born covered in eczema. Then around 4 years old, I attracted rheumatic fever, which had me in the hospital for 3 or 4 months. Couldn't walk. Then when I was 6 years old, we moved from a big city to a smaller village, and that's where suddenly the eczema came back. And it started also, I started having asthma attacks. You know, it was so bad. People don't realize it was not spots of eczema. There were many times that my hands were covered in eczema. It would be this thick on it. And if I would do this, like pus would come out. It was really disgusting. So I could understand other kids, you know, I had long sleeves, turtlenecks. I had to wear gloves, these medicine gloves, these white gloves. And that was before Michael Jackson was hip. So I wasn't hip, trust me. You know, and kids, they spread from you. Nobody wants to hang out with you. Man, you have no clue. You know, lay in bed this for 24/7 for 8 days. Try to do that. That's asthma. Not able to eat, not able to drink, like putting a wet cloth in your mouth because otherwise it shoots in your lung. It's really hard. And when I had asthma, my eczema cleared up. And when I had bad eczema, then the asthma would be better. So it goes hand in hand. A lot of kids have that. But my poor mom, man, because in the middle of the night, I would scratch it all off again. I would have a tile next to my bed and I would hit constantly because the itching is so bad. It's better to have pain. You know, I would try to get the itching away by hitting a brick or hitting something that I couldn't break, you know, but when I could hurt myself, at least the itching would go away. So the eczema was the worst, of course, for the kids, because kids bully you. They don't know what it is. They think it's contagious. So, you know, you get called all kinds of names. Leper was one of the ones that they really like to use. So kids didn't like me. Teachers didn't like me. I had a whole bunch of schools that I visited because I got kicked off a bunch of them because I was too much to handle. When I was 12 years old, we went on vacation to France and I saw a movie here, Enter the Dragon from Bruce Lee. It was a movie 17 years and older, so we were not allowed in. I was 12 and my brother was 14, but we found a way to get in and we saw the movie and that was it. If I will become like that person, my bullying would be stopped. So when I came home, I started training, doing my own kind of stuff, asking my parents, please allow me to do martial arts, but they were always against it, thought it was violence. They're very conservative, my parents. 2 years later, after 2 years of begging, they finally bent and they said, okay, go, do it. Apparently I had a nick for it because I started picking on really fast. And within months I was dropping the adults with back kicks to the body and high kicks and my confidence started to rise. And then I got into a fight with the biggest bully in town who was always after me. They came on their bicycles. They shouted again something, hey leper, watch out, your ears don't fall, or whatever they shouted. And this time I shouted something back. So I put my bike on the stand, on the sidewalk, and I said, I'm not gonna face it now. I'm not gonna stop. And they surrounded me, you know, like kids do. And Shaki, the tough guy, he started, thought he was a tough guy, I guess. Started bouncing his chest in my chest, you know, that's what kids used to do. And challenging me to hit him. So I obliged. I gave him a right straight, knocked him out, and it broke his nose in the process. That was a problem, because now he had to go to the hospital, and that meant that the police was called, and that meant that my mom and dad had a visit from the police. The things you hear as a kid, you know, what they say to you, and everybody's making fun of you, it's a hard thing to do. You always think that it was a curse, but now you realize it was all a setup. It gave me the motivation. It gave me the power to push through. As a young kid, you have no clue. If somebody would have told me, hey, boss, in about 20 years from now, you're going to win a world title in that place. And I go, world title? What? Yeah, fighting, whatever, dude. You know, I would have never expected that. September 21st, 1993 was my first time I was fighting in Japan. I lost 3 fights in total by submission, but that last fight really did something to me. This is when I said, okay, if I want to become something in this sport, I'm going to have to learn this game, this ground game. So I started being very vocal. I started asking every single person, every gym I went to, who wants to train with me, who wants to train me? My poor wife, if I woke her up 6 times in the middle of the night because I would dream a submission, I would wake her up, I would put her in that submission, and she would go, oh my, I say, your shoulder, right? Your shoulder's hurting? Yeah, okay, I would write it down. I go, okay, next time I would try it out in my gym the next day. I would do it during the day. We would walk through the house and say, honey, lean over. She leans over, I would get her in like a guillotine choke. I say, is this hurting your throat or are you getting dizzy now? She goes, I'm getting dizzy. I go, okay, that's a blood choke. So if I do this now, it's hurting your throat, right? Yeah, okay, good. I would write it down again and then try it out in gym. But it worked. We start doing it 2-3 times a day. Obsessed, the whole house is little post-its everywhere with combinations on it. I just couldn't let it go. And it changed my entire career. I never lost a fight again. I won my next 8 fights by submission. Well, 7 by submission, 1 because I dominated him on the ground. And my last 22 fights, I never lost. I really needed a change at that time. I won so many fights in a row, it started to become kind of null. You know, like 19 fights I won at that time in a row. And I think that it relighted the fire in me to go to the UFC. I always wanted to go to the UFC. Roll another one, cause I'm winning. In my photo, looking real photogenic. I went to the UFC, they put a 4-man tournament together, spread out over 2 shows. I was facing Chiyoshi Kosaka, a Japanese fighter who did really well in that organization, Rings I was talking about. That was my first opponent. I stopped him in the overtime, knocked him out. And then I went to the second one, and that was a fight between Kevin Randleman. I had a really tough fight against him. He really beat me up in the first 4 minutes. I mean, my eye socket, everything was filled with blood. I lost a contact lens. At that time, I was wearing contacts. -5.5 I have, so I have no vision pretty much. So with that one eye covered with blood, with the contact lens, the other one, I lost the contact. I couldn't see anything. I was swallowing my own blood because I was laying on my back. My nose is broke. You know, it was all cut up. And we had a stand-up, and the referee said, hey, your nose is broke. You want to keep going? And I go, yeah, no, let's keep doing this. Let's keep fighting. And then I start slowly but surely start getting into the fight. And I start picking him apart. And then slowly, it went to a decision. It went to a split decision victory, which was in favor of me. And I won that fight. By that time, I wanted to retire the heavyweight belt and going to be the first person who holds 2 belts in 2 different weight classes. That was my goal. But injuries started piling up. I had a bad case of tendonitis. My tendons hurt extremely bad in both arms. And once that hits, you're done. In 1997, I moved to America, May 1997. So it's 20 years ago now. From there, I became into the International Fight League. I started doing a TV show here and there. And then, you know, I met Kevin James. Can't stop it. You cannot stop it. He started asking me to come on the show a few times, King of Queens. And then he started doing movies when the show stopped, and I started doing appearances in his movies. And then the big movie came for me was Here Comes the Boom with Kevin James.
I wrestled it. I know how to stop a shot.
Ding, ding, boom, boom, elbow, boom, liver shot, bang, bang.
Well, Kevin is a good Catholic and a devout Catholic. So what he does, we're in Vegas, and he has these speakers coming to the set. If there's off time, why not learn a little bit? I didn't even know how deep he was into the faith. He was very smart about that. Because you tell that to me, I'm probably not gonna do it. I'm like that little kid, right? You know, reverse psychology works with me probably. But just said, hey, somebody said, why don't you do that? You can smoke cigars, get a Coke. You know, we're outside, we have at the cabana. There's an AC in the cabana. Why not? I got some time to kill. Let's sit there with a cigar, just listen to what he had said. I'm so happy that was the first talk I was sitting into because I got sucked in, and that was it. Changed my life. Faith has been in my life from the beginning. I was baptized, I did confirmation, everything, until I was about 12 years old, and we stopped going to church. We did weekly church first, and then I remember that we went on Christmas, and then my dad said, you know, if we only go on Christmas, that's a charade. We'd rather not go anymore, because otherwise it's stupid, I feel bad about that. So we never practiced the faith. So when we stopped going to church, well, I was never really interested. It's, and you know, as a kid, going to a church is a kind of an intimidating thing. There are all these crazy statues there, they look at you, nobody's happy. Looking back, I always ask that question, man. I really would have liked to know what would have happened. After that initial moment, you know, of course I went back home and I started reading the Bible, get an audio Bible as well so I can read and listen to it simultaneously. It will put it better in my mind. That's how I always thought. The first one that got me, that really changed me, because I was that guy, when I read in the Bible that you're enslaved to drinking. Well, let's break this down. You're enslaved to drink. I'm a slave to alcohol. Oh, that I didn't like when I read that. And to me, that did a big thing. I'm not a slave to anything. Nothing controls me. God controls me. I'll give that up, but nothing else is going to control me. For me, one line in the Bible, that was like, enslaved? No, I'm not a slave. I'm not a slave to that. You know, I was a heavy drinker. It stopped me from drinking. You know, it's and now got moderation, something I never in my life had. My friends, they will notice a thing about me when I became a Catholic. I'm still the same guy, same fun. But people think that you completely changed and I'm in church all like praying, oh God, dude, there's all good. It's absolutely not like that. You know, if I go to the gym, I'm not doing verses, and nobody knows. If somebody asks, they're gonna get it. I'll give it to them, you know, with a vengeance. You don't change a thing, but inside and other people, you become a completely different person. You become a better person. And please don't think, you change your night over life. Of course it doesn't work like that, you know, because everybody will jump on it. That's why it's this great secret. God, and where he is, and where to find him. And in the beginning, you don't know. You go, you know, where do I do it? If I pray, I don't feel anything. Or you're supposed to feel something. Or I don't feel anything. You know, it's that thing you're looking for. It's that instant gratification that we are grown up so much now because everything is short attention span, right? But it's really cool. Once you start reading, you go, wow, I never knew this. And now suddenly you're reading for 4 hours. You know, I never had that. I never read books. I started reading books, you know. But if something is interesting, you keep doing it. And this is the part where everybody at home is going to say, yeah, but I don't think this is interesting. But that's the thing. You think that because people tell you that. But it is interesting. Once you learn it, that's what I tell people. Why don't you give it a chance? 3 months, do it. Just 3 months, learn it. Force yourself to do it. I don't have the time for that. How long are you going to take? 30 minutes in the morning, you read about it, wake up half an hour earlier. That's what I do. Very simple. You do that for a week, your body doesn't know anything else anymore. You made it a good habit. Done. You got your 30 minutes. Once you do that and you force yourself to do that, I guarantee you you're going to be invested because you're going to go, wow, this is cool. And you start seeing these things, and you start saying these sayings with the verses, but they start speaking to you, and you see them in different ways. You can explain them in different ways. It's really, it opens you up. It really did that to me. I started to become very philosophical. You think for 1 second that you die and that's it, well, then we live for nothing, pretty much. What do we live for? If there's no greater thing that's going to come after it, it's 100%. You know, I refuse to believe that, and especially after everything that I experienced myself. The thing about Catholicism is that as soon as you start learning about it, real learning about it, you're hooked. You get in there because that it catches you. Everybody's looking for the truth. You have nothing to lose, but you have everything to gain. My question that I always ask to my students is a very simple question. How do you want to be remembered? Now, let's apply this to fighting. How do you want to be remembered? As the guy with all the talent, but never trained really hard because he had all the talent and he lost because he was never in real shape. No. As the guy who cheated and used the PED, performance enhancing drugs. No, don't want to be remembered like that. How do you want to be remembered as a fighter? As a good fighter, a guy who never gave up, a guy who, even if I don't become a champion, that other fighters say, oh, you're going to fight him? Oh, you get ready, dude. That's going to be a tough fight. It's not about getting that championship belt. It's getting the recognition from your peers. Now, if that is very important to me, why don't I want the recognition from God, you know, and be the ultimate good guy? Be a badass, but on top of that, be also just a good person. I think there's nothing more important.
Heartbeats like the end.